common confession, the small catechism by Martin Luther, instructs us with these words.
Confession is of hearts. First, that we confess our sins, and second, that we receive absolution, that is forgiveness, from the Master and as of God Himself, not doubting, but firmly believing that by it our sins are forgiven before God in heaven.
Humble yourselves then before God, confess your sins to Him, and implore His forgiveness.
O Lord, merciful Father, I, a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. By nature, I am a sinful creature. By thought, word, and deed, I have continually transgressed your law. For the sake of the suffering and death, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a penitent and contrite being. Forgive me all my sins, and grant me the power of your Holy Spirit, that I may amend my sinful life.
God be gracious to you and strengthen your faith.
Amen.
As you believe, so let it be. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you are the strength of all who trust in you, and without your aid we can do no good thing. Grant us the help of your grace, that we may please you in both will and deed. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Sunday after Pentecost is from Amos chapter 6. Woe to those who are at ease in Zion, and to those who feel secure on the mountain of Samaria, the noble men of the first nations, to whom the house of Israel comes. Pass over to Calvin and see, and from there go to Haman the great, and go to the Philistines. Are you better than these kings? Or is their territory greater than your territory? O you who look far away the day of disaster and bring near the sea of violence. Woe to those who lie on beds of ivory and stretch themselves out on their couches and eat lambs from the flock and calves from the midst of the stall, who sing idle songs to the sound of the harp, and like David, invent for themselves instruments of music, who drink wine in bowls and anoint themselves with the finest oils, but are not grieved over the ruin of Joseph. Therefore they shall now be the first of those who go into exile, and the revelry of those who stretch themselves out shall pass away. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
epistle is from 1 Timothy chapter 6. Now there is great gain in godliness with contentment, for we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food, clothing, with these, we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evils. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made a good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will display at the proper time, he who is the blessed and only Sovereign, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in an unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, O Christ. seated. The text of the message this morning is from our gospel lesson, recorded in the 16th chapter of St. Luke. Dear Christian friends, I feel sorry for you. I say that with quotation marks. I don't lay that out as pity on you. Not yet. But who do you feel sorry for? When do those words come out of your mouth? When is your heart moved with such compassion and pity that you speak those words, "I feel sorry for you"? There are things that I have trouble watching, that stir those emotions within. I'll be watching television, just as an example, enjoying some lighthearted sitcom, and they go to commercial break, and before I can switch the channel, it's one of those lengthy commercials for abused animals. They're starving. They've been beaten. Dogs and cats in cages looking right into the camera, tearing your heart out. Even more troubling, those commercials for the starving and neglected children. You're probably like me in that when you see those things, your insides just ache. The poor, dirty, unloved children, the unwanted and abused animals, so helpless, so vulnerable, why doesn't somebody do something? Some of us in those moments might be motivated to help, to alleviate the suffering of one of God's creatures or one of our fellow human beings. When those heartstrings are tugged at, we do feel sorry. When the gospel lesson was read, a very familiar account, we don't call it a parable, but it's obvious, a story that Jesus is telling that couples very well with the preceding text in Luke 16. But when that gospel lesson was read, did you feel any of those belly aches? The gospel lesson about two very different men. The first described as being rich. A man who says, feast sumptuously. Every day, Jesus made sure to put that in to kind of let you know the extent. That type of feasting was reserved for special days. But no, Jesus says he was doing it every day, dressed in the finest clothes. A man so consumed with satisfying his own selfish desires that he most likely never acknowledged the second. The one described as being poor, Lazarus by name. The man has nothing. He lays at the gate of the rich man, covered in sores. His heart's desire is to be fed with the scraps that come from the rich man's table. Who do you feel sorry for? The one who's whining and dining, living it up? Or the one who lays there in the dirt? Of course we would feel sorry for the poor man. But we're going to let the master storyteller, Jesus, continue. We have these images in our mind's eye of these two men and their lot here in life. Verse 22 and 23, Jesus said that both of these men died. Right there, death, the great equalizer of all mankind. That which comes to all, the way of the flesh. But of these two deaths, that of the rich man and Lazarus, they are described in stark contrast. Just as their lives were in stark contrast, their description of their death, too, death, Jesus said he was carried by angels to Abraham's side. In the moment of death, this filthy, sore-covered, miserable, insignificant beggar is ushered into heaven by an angelic escort. Of the rich man, Jesus said, he died and was buried and was in torment. Certainly a little clarification here, because Jesus is not teaching that earthly poverty and misery is the ticket to heaven, nor is he saying that riches and wealth are inherently evil, deserving of eternal torment. Perspective clarified through our epistle, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. If earthly wealth was something that kept anyone out of heaven, then Father Abraham would have been disqualified. He was a very wealthy man. Now, there's so much more going on here than simply the rich man, poor man scenario. And we're reminded about the major themes of Luke's gospel in this section. You might recall Jesus saying in the previous week, you cannot serve God and money. It's clear, though, that this rich man used his great wealth to serve himself. Never did he use his wealth in service to others. He didn't give any acknowledgement to the giver of these gifts, nor did he live in faithful response in using these gifts to help others. Jesus makes it clear in these passages that he is speaking of those certainly who are selfish in their wealth, but those who have been given so much and don't use it for the glory of God, primarily the Pharisees, the ones who thought they had it all, the ones who considered themselves sons of Abraham, but refusing to repent, refusing to acknowledge Jesus, the Messiah, the true treasure from heaven that far exceeds anything man considers valuable. So there's a good question for us. Do and can we feel sorry for those who put themselves in danger, even when we see them living sumptuous lives? Can we feel sorry for those who stand unknowingly at the point of falling forever into that eternal torment? Can we feel sorry for those who place themselves in such danger? And I was reminded of something that happened about a week ago. I was filling up my tank, and next to me was another car, and I heard this strange sound that I've never heard at a gas station before. It was the sound of like water hitting pavement. And I look over, and the lady next to me is sitting in her car with the door closed and gas just pouring out. The automatic shutoff obviously didn't work, and she didn't hear it because she was sitting inside her car, and gas is just pouring out. Not only is it pouring out, it is now moving toward me. So I decided I didn't need a full tank of gas at that point. She was completely oblivious to the danger she was in. One spark would have been her end. She had no idea of the danger she was in until someone from the gas station saw it and ran, chastised her a little bit, and pointed her to the sign that said, please remain outside your vehicle. And I was hoping that I would get away before she turned the key. But isn't that indicative? So many people in our world who are on the edge of destruction, they don't even know it. And my momentary anger for her indiscretion was replaced with feeling sorry for her. She must have felt just awful. We need to have that compassion for those who appear to have it all but are ready to fall into everlasting torment. Who do we feel sorry for? Lazarus is in. He made it. The bosom of Abraham. No more sores. No more suffering. And we're reminded of the words of Paul who said in Romans 8, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. He would also write in 2 Corinthians, we do not lose heart, though our outward self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory. How often we sit there with Lazarus saying, oh, woe is me. So easy to let our sufferings take over. We have everything. As we turn back to the Heavenly Father who sets before us this very day the only reason to feel sorry for anyone and the only reason for hope. The only reason to feel sorry for anyone in this life ultimately is those who have no eternity in heaven. That which we know by faith that gives us hope. And that's what we have. Only through Christ and what he has gone through for us. The one who was rich became poor, so that by his poverty we might become rich. And that is the beautiful exchange. He has it all, sacrifices even himself, so that we would know the treasures of heaven. In time, between now and that day when we are ushered into heaven, we take comfort in the words that we hear this day, that we will one day be welcomed into heaven. But in that time, until that day, we have the blessings of God, we have the promise of God, we have the body and blood of the Savior. And lest we forget, we have each other. The blessings of praying for each other and encouraging one another and worshiping with one another. And that is our hope. And that is our comfort. And that is the love of God in Christ Jesus for you. In his name, amen. Please stand. And our creedal statement for this morning is from Luther's Small Catechism in the third article with its meaning. Together we confess, I believe the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
What does this mean?
Church on earth, and keeps it with Jesus Christ.
Dear Heavenly Father, you provide us with your holy word that we might know and believe in Christ. Make us diligent to study your word and to dwell in your promises, that we are content with your provision in this life and joyfully look forward to the life to come. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, remember the men whom you have given the task of being pastors. Strengthen them, that they would be above reproach, as they care for their own households as well as for your church. Preserve them from every snare of the evil one. Give them great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father in heaven, preserve our homes from idols and the sins of idols. Bless fathers and mothers as they teach their children, that generations to come might faithfully guard their hearts and rejoice in your gifts. Rejoicing this day for the baptism of Maxton Smith, be with this precious child and his family, that they would be faithful to the charge to teach and to raise this child into the nurture and admonition of you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O King of kings and Lord of lords, watch over the authorities of this and every nation. Deliver them from the idols of wealth and power, and grant that they will use their offices in service to you and those who have entrusted to their care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, let your mercy come to all who come to you in need of your healing, comfort, and peace. As we name before you this day, Janice, Cindy, Roger, Linda, Peggy, Brenda, Bobby, Johnny, and Stephen, John and Hilda, Lois and Fred, David, Adrian, White, Stein, and Debbie, for Eli, Carrie, Gray, Macy, Wayne, Lisa, Joanne, and Drexel. That they, these your children, would find their consolation in your promises until you deliver them and all of us from our earthly troubles. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, you have rescued us from sin, and now you feed us sumptuously with your Son's body and blood. Grant that all who receive this holy supper today would be preserved from hard-heartedness, clothed in Christ's righteousness, and comforted by your gifts of life and salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And dear Heavenly Father, you deliver your people from the sufferings of this world, and comfort them with eternal life. Receive our thanks for your kindness that you have shown to the saints who have gone before us, and preserve us in true repentance until we too are carried by angels to Abraham's side. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayers, Lord, brought before you in the name and for the sake of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Lord our God. For you have graciously blessed us through the word and heart of Jesus Christ our Lord, who for our sake died on the cross and rose from the dead, put an end to death. Confident of his compassion on us, and rejoicing in the company of the saints on earth and those above, we laud and magnify your holy name.
Thank you.
power to us through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. We give you thanks that in his holy supper, you reveal your sacred presence among us and number us with your saints. Grant that we may receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood as we gather at his command. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This is as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Rise the kingdom.
our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the true faith and the life everlasting. Be pardoned in God's peace. Amen. We pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this secondary gift. We implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and